Field Police Committee. My fellow co-chair is Jackie Gorman. Also with us this evening are three representatives from each of our 10 council districts on the Neighborhood and Improvements Committee, and they've been appointed by each of their respective city council members. Before we start, we have an announcement regarding Spanish translation services. If you'd come to the front microphone, please.
Para los que necesiten servicios de traducción al español, pueden pasar al vestíbulo y tomar audífonos para escuchar el programa de bonos 2017 en español. Gracias.
All right, thank you. Tonight's meeting will include presentations from city staff. First, a follow-up on the November 17th meeting and additional neighborhood improvement areas for committee consideration. An overview of the November 29th and 30th meetings with Neighborhood Association leadership. And following that, we'll have a committee discussion on the ranking of committees' recommended neighborhood improvement areas and a preview of urban renewal planning process and content. Our meeting tonight will be mainly dedicated to the committee discussion and analysis on neighborhood improvement areas and a final recommendation for City Council. And with that, we'll ask for a staff presentation on Neighborhood Improvement Committee follow-up from our November 17th meeting. Peter?
Okay, good evening. Thank you, Jim and Jackie. And this is our final meeting, right, our fifth meeting. And so several of the committees already this week had their final meetings as well. The Parks Committee finished on Monday. And then on Tuesday, our Facilities Committee finished. And so this is our final meeting. We want to thank you on behalf of the city manager and the city for the work that you've done. This committee, I've gone to all five of them, just about every meeting. But this one has been a real good learning experience for the city staff and for you as well. And maybe a little more challenging than the other committees because of the newness of this area. So we want to especially thank you for your expertise and your time and attention and all the work that you put into it. You've done a great job, so thank you. In front of you, you may see, I think we beat out the other committees because they didn't get Christmas gifts. But and I found out that these came from Beverly Watts Davis. And you remember her talk about the banquet, right? So I'm not sure if she's egging us on here with these cookies or not, but anyway, that was real nice of her. She's not going to be here tonight, but those gifts are from her, and so we want to thank her for that thoughtfulness. Okay, so with that, I just have a few comments to make tonight, and I'm going to go over the calendar with you and just remind you of some of the follow-up material that we sent to you. And then we're going to have Ed Guzman, our city attorney, speak to you a little bit before you guys make your final vote tonight about ethics and any conflicts of interest that you might have in the vote tonight. We want to make sure everybody feels comfortable and there's no either perceived or real ethics issue or conflict of interest issue. So we'll talk to you about that tonight to make sure you're comfortable in the work you'll do tonight. But before we do that, let me just go over the calendar again and remind you. We did have our fourth meeting back in November 17. And then we held two meetings, which about eight or nine of you all attended with our neighborhood leadership people across the community. We held a meeting in the east side of the city and then the west side of the city that gave neighborhood leaders a chance to learn more about this proposition and learn about the areas that we have presented that you all have refined. And we'll share with you tonight some of the comments from those two meetings. They were very well attended, and we got some good feedback, and so we'll share that with you this evening. Tonight is our fifth meeting, and also tonight we'll show you some of the survey results that you all submitted. About a third of you on the second survey submitted comments during about a week period in the first part of December. So we'll show you that feedback as well that'll help you in your final ranking tonight. This committee, unlike the other four, has a different and maybe a little bit of a bigger calendar. We want to remind you one more time in case you'd like to attend any one of the next several meetings or public hearings. So after your vote tonight on the designated areas, next Wednesday at 2 o'clock with City Council, your co-chairs, Jackie and Jim and myself, will present to the full City Council your recommended areas for inclusion. In the urban renewal plan, and ultimately in this bond package. So that's Tuesday at 2 at the city's, they call it the Municipal Plaza building, right across the street from City Hall. If you'd like to attend, it's also televised. I think Channel 21 is our local channel, but you can watch it on TV as well if you can't attend the meeting, if you have interest to do so. And then the following day, City Council in their regular business meeting will adopt the areas for inclusion in the urban renewal plan. They won't adopt the plan, but rather just the designated areas based on your recommendation, so that in January we can have a public hearing with the community. And this is where you all may want to attend as well, or some of the neighborhood leaders who are in the audience tonight. So there'll be a public hearing on January 18 on the ultimate areas that the council selects for that urban renewal plan. And then we'll let about 2 weeks pass based on the councils. They don't meet on the fourth Thursday of the month. And so after that public hearing, there'll be about a 2 week lapse, and that'll give the council and staff time if they want to adjust any of the areas based on that public hearing. And so on February 2nd, City Council will adopt the urban renewal plan and essentially adopt or locked in the areas that they want to include in the bond program. And then on the 9th of February, that's when City Council on another business meeting will call for the election. That'll be the official action they take to call for the whole bond program election, the $850 million. Okay, so that's our calendar. You can call us or email Jessica if you have any questions along the way, if you want to find out more about it. Do we have a question before?
Thank you. Just a question on the calendar. I see the adoption of the urban renewal plan for February 2nd. Do you have a date for when that would be released for public review and comment?
It would probably be released the Friday at a minimum, or at the latest, the Friday before that. So that would be what you got? Before the public hearing? Okay. Well, the initial one, there'll be a draft for the public hearing that'll be released the Wednesday before. Probably with the agenda briefing memo, the Wednesday or the Friday before. I'm going to have these guys get some dates for us, and then we'll give them to you.
So just to be clear, there would be less than 1 week for the public or anyone who's interested to review the urban renewal plan document itself and submit any feedback to their city council member?
Let me look at the date real quick. So the public hearing is going to be on... Where is it at? The 18th of January, right? So can somebody tell me the Wednesday before? What is that day? The 11th? Okay, so on the 11th of January, the city will post for the city council and the broader community what we call the council briefing memo about this item, which will be on the 18th at the B session, at the public hearing. And attached to the briefing memo will be the draft urban renewal plan. So a week in advance of the actual hearing, the urban renewal plan in its draft form will be available to the community and the city council. That night at 6 o'clock, that public hearing's at 6 o'clock in the city council chambers. The community, anybody interested in wanting to comment on the urban renewal plan and the designated areas within there, will have the right to do so. There'll be a public hearing. It's like 3 minutes per individual, 5 minutes per group. And then from that, the council with staff, if there's a certain direction the council wants to take in the urban renewal plan because of the community input, we can change the draft plan. Then the next event then is the 2nd of February. And the Wednesday before that is what? Okay, so on January 25th, similarly, from that previous action, on the 25th of January, we'll post the briefing memo for the adoption of the urban renewal plan, and the final draft will be attached to that briefing document. All that material is online at the city's website, and it'll be available for review.
Could I make a request? This may already be in your plan, but when the first briefing memo, or whenever any of these documents are ready for public notice and review, it'd be great if you could also send them to the committee again and the individuals who have attended the meetings and given you their contact information.
Okay, we have all your contact information, so that's a great idea. Jessica's here. She's shaking her head, no problem. So, okay, good suggestion. Okay, I'm going to move on to the last thing. I think somebody told me don't tell them this again, but just in case you may have missed that meeting. This is your charge, right? It's just to select, you know it already, but just to select designated areas. In a moment, you'll hear from our attorney about conflicts of interest. And so what we're not selecting and what you're not recommending is projects or parcel specific, right? you're going to recommend tonight is designated areas that will be included, where in the future we can do some housing projects with for-profit and nonprofit sector persons. Okay, before we get into this section, let me just remind you that we did send to you all the questions that were asked from your fourth committee meeting, and I did just want to point out that there was a committee member that recommended we take off some of the parcels that were close to highways for air quality purposes, and we've done that. We made several adjustments to the maps that took those areas out, and I just want to highlight that, and the maps have been included. Okay, so with that, what I'm going to do is invite Ed Guzman, our city attorney, up, who's going to talk a little bit now about the ethics issue and conflicts of interest and your final vote tonight. And then after that, this will just take about 3 to 5 minutes. We'll have Richard Keith walk us through a little bit more material, and then the rest of the night will be yours.
Hello, everyone. I just wanted to give you a little bit of a refresher on the ethics guiding principles that our city attorney provided to you all in that first meeting. And, you know, it's probably not a surprise. We've had multiple questions come up from multiple committee members across all five committees about how ethics applies to what you all are doing and what conflicts of interest may be. So first, we want to just remind you all that you are an ad hoc advisory committee. So you're appointed by the mayor in consultation with each of the council members, but you're not appointed because of state law, federal law, or an ordinance. This is something you're here to inform and advise council and make your best possible recommendation. And so that's why the makeup of the committee is the way that it is. We have a cross-section of volunteers for nonprofits, neighborhood associations, people that have knowledge of the industry, but most importantly, you all have knowledge of your districts, the makeup of those districts, and what projects may or may not work within those districts. So all of that is to ensure that the committee hears and considers input from each district. You analyze each of these areas, but you also have to weigh that against making sure that the process is a fair one, is transparent, and that there's really no influence or appearance of impropriety when it comes to direct monetary interest in any of the outcomes of your actions. So as Peter mentioned, I'm gonna mention it one last time so we completely beat this horse to death, is that you are very unique compared to the other four bond committees. You are recommending designated areas for inclusion in the city's urban renewal plan and ultimately in the bond. So you're actually integral in two different things that you're doing. You're part of a very important legal mechanism to determine what becomes part of that urban renewal plan and the bond. You're not identifying specific areas for purchase, and you're not identifying specific projects. So there's not that granular sort of designation that's being done in some of these other committees. Nonetheless, we want to make sure that it's clear that if any of you have a financial interest, and ultimately it's going to be, do you own a property in any of these designated areas, we would strongly advise that you not vote regarding that designated area. And it's a pretty common sense sort of thing. Also, if your employer has a financial interest, or you think they could receive bond funds directly through this process in a designated area, you should also recuse and you should not vote. And because of the way this is set up, the way that it's organized, if you think about it, what we've talked about is that the Urban Renewal Agency will purchase properties, make ready, and then the developer will have to buy the properties from the city. So again, it's going to be primarily looking at, does an employer own a property within any of these designated areas? Ultimately, it's up to you to use your own individual judgment and common sense on whether you vote. If you have questions about any of this, I'll be sitting over there. Come over. I'll talk to you individually rather than trying to get into a discussion amongst all of you. All right? Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Richard.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to talk to you about an area, a potentially additional area here, an area to consider that was brought to our attention by the members of the committee who are from District 8 and the District 8 Council Office. So this particular area, for your consideration, this was a recommendation for your consideration by those committee members, is what we're calling Oak Hollow in District 8. So this particular area is the area that you see up here in purple, okay? This is located near Babcock and Prue Road. And just for your reference, over here is Heemner and Fredericksburg and IH 10. So the medical center would be over in this area, okay? Just to help to orient you. And I'm just going to go through it really briefly so that you have information that you'll need in order to consider whether you want to vote to include this or not include this among the other areas that you finalize this evening. So it's located in that area that I mentioned right there. It includes two parcels. One of them is the Oak Hollow Mobile Home Park, and the other is a vacant parcel immediately to the north of the park. So we believe that the area does, after careful examination, we do believe that it meets the state's requirements. And remember, there are state's requirements and then there are strategic criteria that we apply. In terms of the state's requirements, we think that it does meet the state's requirements. The mobile home park itself has a predominance of dilapidation. It has streets that are don't provide adequate access in and out of the property. It has some unsafe and unsanitary conditions, which I'm going to speak more about in just a moment. And then the area just to the north of it is made up of open land. The city's there's a little bit of a story here, and if you've been following the news lately, there have been a couple of news stories about this particular property. So this is a property where there have been report and evidence of unsafe and unsanitary conditions on the site. There is sewage that is present that children have been having access to along sort of in the open area of in between the homes there, the mobile homes. On the western side of that property, which is right over here, along here, if you're kind of following the laser, that side right there, our city's Development Services Department has already issued an order to vacate the premises because it was so bad that they really were not livable conditions because of the sewage that was present and a breakdown of multiple septic systems. So it's pretty bad. Not all of that property has been under that order to vacate. The ones that were, the Department of Human Services for the city has been working very closely and very intensively with those families to relocate them to other housing options. So what's left are about approximately 60 families. So that helps to orient you just a little bit to this property. Now, the issue here from the city's perspective is that there are legal issues between the owner of the property and the residents of the mobile homes in terms of their lease agreements for the property that they are leasing that could keep the residents in place for a substantial amount of time, for a year or more. We don't know all of the details associated with that, but that is our best understanding of the situation. So I do want to point out to you, as you consider this area, that we have told you multiple times that we have strived here to avoid any situations that might lead to resident displacement, and we stand by that position. That is still our position. This would be a little bit different than all of the other areas that we have considered in that it has the probably the greatest possibility of resident displacement. Now, having said that, we don't know all of the details. We know that the owner is interested in evicting the residents who are currently there. It's a very sad situation for the and an unsanitary condition in a situation that involves unsanitary conditions for the residents who are located in this mobile home park. Now, having said all of that, on the other hand, this property, if there were no residents on it, could constitute an opportunity for the development of housing that is affordable to the working families who have jobs in the medical center down there or in the UTSA area on the opposite side. So it's a complex situation to consider, and I just wanted to present that to you in advance of your discussion about finalizing the area. So I don't know if there's any further discussion that you would like to have now, or if you'd like to just have that discussion as a part of your discussion on finalizing the areas. I would say that's up to you, the co-chairs, to decide.
Before we open this up for general discussion, I'd like some of the, or at least someone from District 8, to address this to the committee, please. Go ahead.
Okay. Thanks so much, Richard, for that presentation. So for a second, I want to address my fellow committee members and submit to you that displacement is already happening in this location. This location gives us a unique opportunity, and keeping in mind that this is just the possible area, right? We're submitting areas for potential housing. This particular piece gives us an opportunity to be really creative about how we can address the issues that are happening there right now. I don't see how, Richard, and I guess that was a question that I had when you are talking about, you know, from the city's perspective, you know, there are lease issues with the lease, but then we look at the sort of timeline for the bond, and so I don't really see that as something that would stop me from supporting this possibility of helping out these individuals in Oak Hollow. I know that my fellow District 8 colleagues, we've spoken about this, and they're also fully in support of this area being added as a consideration. So I just ask that we, you know, I know we've talked about maximizing the bond investments that are happening around other areas, but for a second here, I think we should talk about the opportunity to provide a creative and fair and just opportunity for people in this area.
I have a question for Richard. Is the current owner, or in the event that the city acquires the property, is anyone providing any relocation assistance for the people that live on site right now?
So currently, the Department of Human Services is working to finalize the housing options that each individual mobile home resident has for that western side over here. And that's what is happening right now. That's the activity that's happening in terms of relocation assistance at the moment. I'm not aware of the specific timeline for an eviction process for the remaining estimated 60 residents.
And is the issue right now, it's not a stormwater issue, it's a sewage issue, is that correct?
My understanding is that it's a sewage issue. and a breakdown of septic systems.
Okay. So if the property on the north side of Prue Road, for example, were to be acquired, it's not necessarily going to contribute to any stormwater runoff or anything into the
I don't know the answer to that, but we would examine that very carefully before we were to seek to acquire any property, like if it was in the floodplain, for example, or had drainage issues. But also, you know, let's keep in mind that the bond fund, you know, one of the eligible uses of the bond funds is to do infrastructural improvements such as extension of utilities and drainage, right? So
Does any of this area lie within the scope of work that any of the other committees are doing, such as drainage or anything else?
I would defer to Razi from TCI on that. He's indicating no.
Okay, we've got some signs up there. I'm going to try to get them in the order that I saw them. So I think the first one I saw was Peggy Sue Wilson from District 10.
Thank you. I don't want to see anybody living in bad conditions or unsafe conditions, but can you clarify on the current draft that we have of the Urban Renewal Plan? Page 4 says funds may not be used to permanently displace residents, and page 6 says that in the event, in the case of unavoidable displacement, bond funds may be used to provide reasonable relocation assistance. So there's a discrepancy. So we want to make sure that's clear if we can do it.
Yeah, here is a place where we may have our outside counsel help us out a little bit. My understanding, and I'm going to ask for clarification from Clayton, is that costs that are associated with displacement are an eligible use under the bond. However, the city is making a strategic decision to avoid displacement in the bond program.
That's correct. You can pay reasonable costs of displacement and relocation.
Okay, we might want to fix that in there, but I like your other idea of possibly getting the sewage connected, that maybe these people don't have to be displaced if the septic system could be corrected or it could be hooked up to city services or something. That'd be awesome. It'd be a win-win for everybody.
Yeah, I should clarify, though, that when I say that, all of the improvements that we can do are in the service of creating housing, right? So they're not intended to be replacing other parts of the bond where, like, so for example, where there's not a drainage project identified in another bond package, that we could just use this bond to do a drainage improvement. That's not the intent of this bond. The intent of this bond is to create housing for working families. And so the infrastructural improvements that we do are in support of that housing.
And let me just clarify one more thing. The mobile home park that's here is privately owned. So the septic system that's there is privately owned, all privately installed. So there would be an issue with the city coming in and essentially giving a financial benefit to that individual property owner by fixing that septic system. It would be a gift of public funds. So there's a little bit of a problem with that as well. So on top of what Rick brought up,
don't we do gifts or grants for other homeowners to fix up properties that they can't fix?
We can, but again, you have to fit very specific criteria and you'd have to say that it's for a public purpose. Here, it would be if the public purpose is to serve those individuals that are residing there, that's one thing, but is it the owner that actually gets the benefit of that instead? And that's why we'd have to wait. It would be very complicated for the city to go in and provide that for linkage. That would be something that really they should do. Yeah, and certainly we couldn't do it with the bond proceeds because of the parameters of the urban.
No, I was thinking of directing them to the other programs that are out there, because I know there's some for adding people's for fixing roofs and stuff. Maybe we could direct this homeowner somewhere else. But anyways.
Okay.
If I can, I need to make a correction on the question of was there any additional projects in the other propositions for this area? The answer is yes. It's not no. The answer is yes. So this is Prue Road here, right? And there is a street project that is $27.6 million. to redo Prue Road, to widen the road, to reconstruct the roadway with curbs, sidewalks, driveway approaches, and drainage improvements as needed. And the limits are from here, which is Babcock, all the way over here, which is Lorette, I guess. So this whole Prue Road is a $27.6 million improvement project in our street proposition, okay? And then let me just add one thing on the displacement issue. Given that there's many areas, right, so far I think there's 12 that you all are recommending, the staff would be mindful and would watch and would look for the opportunity that if an investment was made on this property, an ideal time would be when there's no more potential litigation and people are already moved off. That would be the ideal scenario. So we could put it on, if you all want to recommend it, we'd be mindful about doing any projects there until those favorable conditions exist, right? So if you put it on, it gives us, the community, the opportunity to address it one day. If it's not on, then we don't have the opportunity to provide housing in this area. Just keep that in mind.
Sylvia, you're next.
My question was exactly that. Are there any other projects going on? But also another was, is the owner of the property on the other side of the road the same person or not?
No. Two separate owners.
Okay, Linda Lopez George. Did you have your sign up? Did you put it down? Okay. Michael Taylor.
So one of the projects that this committee was shown was the East Meadows project, which is replacing the former Wheatley Courts Housing Authority project. And so I guess, and in the instances where the Housing Authority upgrades their facilities, residents are temporarily displaced, but they're given the opportunity to come back. And so I guess my question is, and maybe it's just kind of a question for everyone, but is it displacement if you were to provide the existing residents with the opportunity to come back after the site is redeveloped and you have, you know, new affordable housing options that are, you know, safe and decent? And if that's not displacement, is there a way through the RFP process, and I understand that it's in no way part of our charge to even consider that RFP process, but would it be hypothetically possible for that to be a condition of the property going to a developer, that they give, you know, the former residents an option to move back in essentially once it's redeveloped as a way of mitigating this potential displacement issue?
Yeah. I think we can't say it's necessarily impossible to include that as a condition of a potential contract. As to the first question, I think the first question is more of a question for the committee, right?
So, yeah.
We can discuss that in greater detail during our discussion period. Mr. Dickerson from District 2.
Thank you. I think I heard the answer to this question, but to be clear, in light of the septic mess that exists there in that one property, whose responsibility will that be in terms of a cleanup?
So currently this property is owned by a private owner. That private owner has responsibility to maintain safe and sanitary living conditions on the property. For the portion of the property that rose to a level of not being habitable, an order to vacate was issued for the safety of the residents by the city's Development Services Department. But for the remaining residents, the owner, the burden of livability for the site is on the owner.
I hear you, but if still we opt to acquire that property and the owner defaults or for whatever reason is unable to take care of that mess, what then does the city do with regard to that particular parcel?
Are you talking about properties that
Particular parcel, since we are fully aware of the sewage mess that exists there.
Yeah, so the city has been working with the residents that were ordered to vacate to help them to identify other options for housing. So the city's been very engaged with those residents. In terms of cleaning up the sewage, I am unaware of the city taking direct action to clean up the sewage on this private property. Is that what you're asking?
Indeed. If that doesn't happen, if the private owner doesn't take care of the mess, and if the city opts not to, then is this a parcel that we will continue to consider?
I think it's a parcel that we're going to consider tonight, and I think that must be the answer to your question.
I think we're missing part of the question, or at least I'm hearing a piece of the question that's not getting answered.
Okay.
Mr. Dickerson, I think this is the answer to what you're asking. If the city acquires any of these parcels, any parcel in any of the areas that we're talking about, and it requires some sort of environmental remediation before it is turned over to a developer, then the city will do that remediation before it is turned over to a developer. They will factor that into the price, I would imagine, and they would take care of that. That's the whole purpose of this whole urban renewal plan, is to amass these parcels, do the necessary remediation, and pass it on to a developer. So if that was your question, I think that's the answer.
I think that's what I was trying to get at.
Very good. Okay.
But with the limited funds that we have to address neighborhood improvement areas, is this something that we want to put high on the list or not?
Yeah, let me just add, Jackie, if I can, that the current situation is a code violation, right? This is against the city's codes, and so they've been cited. In cases where people don't comply with code violations and clean them up, the city has the legal authority to place a lien on the property. And once the property is sold, we can get some of the money back potentially if we had to clean it up. So.
Okay, Mr. Dina, District 6.
Good evening, everyone. In deference to the members from District 8, I know this is a very touchy-feely situation because we've all been watching this on TV for a number of months. So I mean no harm with what I'm about to say. This is a sticky situation that was pre-existing that the councilman, for whatever reason, hasn't taken care of. Maybe he can't. Maybe it's because of the legal issues. I don't know. However, I think it's going to be a sticky issue for us, for the bond, if it looks like, and perception is reality, if it looks like one of our city councilmen slid something at the 11th hour under the door, and then we add it to the list, that's perception. And then the perception goes to the votes. And we don't need more bad perception, because you know how bonds go. There's always going to be people against things. And we talked to a number of people at our meetings just last week that were against stuff. Remember the two meetings that we had with neighborhood associations? Because some people have already come here and said, who did you talk to? Because you sure didn't talk to me. So that begs the question for staff. Has the staff talked to Jade Oaks and any of the other organized homeowner associations in the area? Have you heard from them? Are they for or against, or?
About this particular property?
Yes, sir.
We are not aware of their position on this.
Okay.
Over regular property.
So that's another negative, because we've already heard that as a committee. People have come here and said, you didn't talk to us first. As a matter of fact, at the Wednesday meeting, one of the ladies that came to speak, one of the citizens said, you know, this meeting tonight should have been held months ago because you didn't bring us into it. So again, there's a negative perception, and I'm not beating up on staff. I'm just saying what my feeling is, and I don't want us to fail. We have all put our hearts into this, and from the discussions, I know you guys have the same feeling. We want to be successful, especially because it's a first-time go, and we'd like to see it be replicated in the future. So we have to be very sensitive to that. So my issues are, additionally, that I believe the northern piece of property there was an attempt to either upzone or downzone that sometime back, and it failed. And I don't know the whole story about it.
That was now, actually a piece of property that was further north of that. It's not that property.
It's not that one? Uh-huh. Okay, I take that back then. The second issue that I'll bring up then is about the existing issue at the trailer park. It's an owner-operator issue. I don't think we should get involved in it at this time because it's also the city's issue. What does the city do with a dangerous structure? They say there is a dangerous structure. You have 30 days or 45 days or whatever it is. If you don't do it, we will. And we've all seen that on TV. They're out there and they knock it down, they take care of it, and then they charge the person responsible. I think it's shameful if we have such a negative area in our city that we have to move people out, and the city hasn't already said, you've got 30 days or 45 days, either you take care of it or we will, because the health of our citizens is paramount. And so for that, I would blame our city councilmen for that area for not stepping up and making it an issue, a more important issue than in the 11th hour bringing it before this committee and asking us to put it on there. And my heart goes out to the people that are impacted. It's not that I'm heartless, but I'm looking at the big picture. All the other taxpayers that are going to have to pay back this bond over the next X number of years, and we're going to tag this on at the last minute, and it's not going to smell good. It's not going to smell good from the voters' perspective, and I think we need to just think about that before we add number 17 onto our list. And I thank you. I yield the floor.
Mr. McDonald.
I'll say what he said. But from the very beginning, perception of what we were to do in our charge was to not use eminent domain and not displace anyone. Now, if this property was free and clear of people who have been resettled, that might be a different story. We don't even know all the legal issues and how long it's going to come along. And we get the detail in this room because we've been working those things, and I know many of us have sat here and gone to these areas to look. But what does the public see? You told me we will not displace anybody. You told me that. And at these community meetings, I have gone on record with everybody I have spoke to said, we will not displace anybody. This is a time to trust. This is like the aquifer. But we need this project to go forward with quality projects that keep our word and build the trust for government and to do good things for people. And I bring tears to my eyes for that situation there. But this committee can't solve the current problem. We can't resolve the legal issues. We can't find them housing. All we can do is encourage people to do right. And the right here for this committee, in my view, is we made a pledge from day one to build the confidence with the people of the voter that we will not displace anyone and we will earn your trust for the future of San Antonio and its residents. Thank you.
Mr. De Leon.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are looking at a very serious problem. I'm almost positive that this area is located in the aquifer zone. Correct me if I'm wrong. So something has to be done, but it has to be done immediately. Our bond proposal It's going to take a long time. And this area, according to what we've been informed, it's being polluted, if that's what the problem is. My way of solving this problem is for SAW to get involved, the city and the community, and we, the citizens of this city, should put pressure on the people to solve this problem. We don't want this kind of contamination into our water system. Thank you.
I feel like I need to say something right now because I am really disturbed by the conversation that we're having. Not so much that we're having the conversation, but by the basis of the conversation, which leads me to question a couple of things. Number one, we have said this for the 5 meetings that we've been at and the 1 bus trip. Putting an area in this urban renewal plan does not mean that there will be a project there. So it is so early for us to be talking about displacement. You know, this bond program is 5 years long. Who knows what the status of this project or this property will be in year 5? But that's not my issue. My issue is that next week, in the week after that, and the week after that, the 30 of us sitting around, the 32 of us sitting around this table, are gonna have to go out and talk to our fellow citizens and explain to them what this bond is. And if we can't understand it here at this table, how in the heck are we gonna make our fellow citizens understand it? I am really concerned about that. You know, somebody brought up that this is a pilot and we don't wanna fail on the first time out, and we don't. So I'm asking myself, and I think I want to ask you guys this because I want you to be real honest with yourself because this is the time. Are we ready to do this? Or is this something that maybe we need to go to council and say, council, we did our best, but we need to table this for right now because we're not ready. I would rather us do that than do something crazy that we can't explain to our fellow citizens and gets defeated, and then we have to fight twice as hard the next time we try to do some very important work. You guys know how I feel about this. This is a crisis in our community, but it will still be a crisis if we can't convince our fellow citizens to vote for it. And if we don't understand it, how can we help them understand it? That's all I got to say. Linda, you had your sign up.
Thank you. Just to address the comment about perception as reality, and I totally agree with that. Last Saturday, the council member hosted a breakfast at Magnolia House where over probably 100 of us were in attendance, and those in attendance were HOA presidents of District 8 and others from within District 8 in those HOA associations. So there was a large contingency of presidents, and this was raised to their attention. And he did discuss this particular piece of property as being a potential being added on for the urban renewal plan. And he explained how this is a new initiative and how he welcomed any kind of feedback and comments that anybody from the audience there had at that time or any time thereafter. So in respect to the staff not specifically going to Jade Oaks or any of the other HOAs, there was a large representation. There was a sign-in sheet, so you're welcome to probably request that from the council member's office if you want to review all of the presidents and other officers who were in attendance. Thank you.
Ricardo.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Ms. Gorman, thank you. I completely agree with what you just said. I think part of the problem we have is that this bond is extremely confusing. Just start with the name, Neighborhood Improvements. I know most people when they first came here did not recognize that this was a housing bond. They actually thought we were talking about improving neighborhoods, improving streets, improving lights. And that's not what we're doing. We're talking about housing projects. So I agree, and I can totally understand why there is some confusion here, because from the very beginning, from the very start, the name of it is even confusing, and people are a little misguided as to what the purpose is here. And I get that from this conversation we're having right now. And what's really striking to me is we're talking about an area that right now has immediate needs that essentially need to be addressed today. And Peter just stood up and told us that that's what the city's doing with code. He's also very clearly told us at every single meeting, it's one of the first slides here, that we are not picking a single project. All we are doing is picking an area. So while yes, if we include this, that area is now eligible, but those needs that you are addressing that needs to be fixed today, there is no guarantee that a single dime is going to go to that. So I'm not sure that if we're talking about a need that needs to be addressed right now, that this is the best solution. Because at the end of the day, this isn't going to get approved until the election in May. The other thing I'd like to have, and maybe if staff could clarify this, this came to my mind when we were talking about rankings. Even though we are ranking these projects in terms of these are the projects that we feel are high priority, or these are the projects we feel that should not be here, those rankings, as far as I understand it, are in no way dictating the order or the priority that staff is going to use in determining which projects get funded. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct, Ricardo.
That's correct, Ricardo. The committee, this 32-member committee, the rankings are in part to help you decide what your recommendation should be. We'll use this information after the election, as we begin to look at places to acquire property, but we're not bound by, or we don't have to be legally tied into going in that priority order. Okay?
Given that, I still say, like I said last time, this is a pilot program. If you want this to succeed, successful pilot programs do not overreach. And that's what we need to make sure we do. We don't need to have 15, 14, or 12. In my mind, 3 to 4 areas is all that should be included. And if the city is successful with that, then this will pass again. If they are not, then we are going to have the mistrust of the people for a long time.
Ms. Connie.
Thank you so much. I also agree with you. It is very confusing, and it's even more difficult for me to try to explain it to some of the people that I've spoken to, whose areas we have been discussing. I have a question for staff. If we have had this issue in this particular area with the septic, and we all know how dangerous that can be, I would like to know from code compliance how many times they have been called on. How many times have they gone over there to see if the problem has been corrected? Right here, right now, code compliance needs to be called on the carpet and ask them to go and take a look at that and provide this committee information on that property and what they've done and been able to do or not do and why.
Ma'am, in response to your question, we don't have that information currently. The development services staff is not here tonight.
Can we get them to give us that information?
We can follow up with development services department about that.
Ms. Connie, though, this is our last meeting. When we leave here tonight, we need a recommendation one way or another to council. So I'm not sure that we're going to have time to get information from staff in response to your question, just because we've got to come up with a decision before we leave here tonight. Colleen, is your sign up? Okay.
I agree that it would have been beneficial for this whole process to start 6 months ago, so we would have had more time. I think this whole committee feels like we've had less input perhaps from citizens that have taken up our time, but I think we still have a lot of questions. So, you know, possibly tabling it for the future to ensure success is beneficial. That being said, you know, we are going to vote on something tonight. The way I see this, I do not feel like it was a last-minute addition. I do believe that code compliance has been addressing this issue. There is a process they have to go through. They have basically done what they would do in any circumstances where there was a health and safety violation and made sure that those people were relocated for their own safety, not to discriminate against them, but for their own safety. They will, I know, follow up to make sure that that area is cleaned up by this landlord, or they will take the steps necessary to file a lien, which would be on the whole property, and he would have to, in order to continue having any residents there, would have to clean up that area. I think if we exclude this, we are eliminating a possibility for getting a property in an area where that housing is needed at a reasonable price. If this owner cannot clean up that property, this isn't like radioactive waste, it's sewage. The city deals with sewage all the time. It gives us the opportunity to go in and put the infrastructure in to fix that property. I have full faith that none of that would be done until all of the other things would have been taken care of as far as relocating people. And I'm not saying the city would relocate, I'm saying through the normal process. That landlord has already issued eviction notices because he wasn't happy because the city was awning. So I think it presents an opportunity for us. It does not guarantee that that man's land will ever be purchased by the city or developed, but I think it provides us with an opportunity that we shouldn't ignore, and I do not believe, I think all along we were charged with identifying areas, and I think that's what the council district has done. As a matter of fact, the first meeting we met, I said to CODA, I'm sure it would be nice if we could fix that mobile home park with these funds. So, you know, it's not like that hasn't been considered as an addition from the start.
Thank you. And I just wanted to clarify and also to make the point that it is a mistake to assume that we are recommending this area, believing that this is going to be the cure-all to the issues that are happening there. And it's a mistake to assume that the council office hasn't been actively addressing these issues from the second they found out that this was going on there. This is, more than anything, we know, I mean, by golly, Peter, we are doing what you have told us a million times, identifying areas for opportunities, potential opportunities, and that is what is happening right now. This is a unique area. Yes, we've been given a backstory, but an opportunity that we would make a mistake to not include it.
Before we start giving people a second opportunity to speak on this issue, does anyone who has not spoken yet on this issue have anything else to say? Are you sure? Okay.
Okay, so I guess my question is the idea of the sewage. I understand that the city would go in and fix this problem, but has there been an environmental study done on this sewage that's there? I mean, raw sewage is a problem as far as I can tell. And if we were going to leave out the fire station or the fire academy because there was a question of environmental, potential environmental issues, then my fear is that this, aside from everything else, would also have a potential downside with this environmental issue attached to it.
Just to be clear, the city, we haven't said that the city, would clean this area up. What we have said is that it's the property owner's doing, and it's the property owner's responsibility, and the property owner has been issued a code violation from the city, which tells him you have to go to court probably and get this cleaned up. If he doesn't do it, or she, if they don't do it, then we can place a lien in the property. we're still not cleaning it up, you know, so they, so we're not, you know, so we don't know what will happen to the property. We don't know the extent of the environmental condition, unlike the fire academy that we do know. The best outcome would be that the property owner resolves the issue. It gives us, as the District 8 reps have told you, gives us or gives the community an opportunity to consider this. It doesn't mean we're going to do a project here. So all those are, there's a lot of unknowns in this, but except for the ones that I talked to you about.
Okay, and then I guess the second part is that I went to the meeting on Wednesday, and I did hear these individuals who had, it was almost vitriolic, it was a tough crowd, and I can't imagine going forward trying to sell something like this to them. In fact, it was difficult to even get them to understand, because this is such a new process. As Ricardo always mentions, they're looking at eminent domain. That's the one and only thing that they're hearing out of all of this, especially at my table anyway. It was very difficult to breach any sort of conversation, because they came in already with their effective filters up, and they were just thinking eminent domain, you know, someone else has to purchase this property, and someone else, you know, the family members of these lots need to be the ones that have first priority on this. They weren't understanding the process. It's taken me, and I will remind you that I came in late to this process, and so it took me almost 2 weeks to actually just get the vernacular down. But it's taken me a great deal of time to actually try to understand the concept behind it that we just talked about, and that not these are areas, and not all the areas, even though they are chosen, are going to be guaranteed that they'll be fixed, that we're just kind of throwing the net out there, asking everyone to be part of the banquet, I guess. And so there is a perception. These people were very, very tentative, and the thing that they wanted was transparency. So it's going to be, I'm trying to look at this, at the how am I going to go to the folks in my area or in my district and say to them, this is what I'm proposing, or this is what I've proposed, with a clear conscience, knowing that there is this tentative mistrust, if you will, about the process, because they don't understand it. And they've already got their assumptions about it and assertions. So I just thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Folks, we have like 48 minutes left, and we got a lot of work to do. So I'm going to ask everybody to put their signs down for a minute. I want Richard, do you have any more presentation that you need to give us?
You know, honestly, there are some slides that I could present to you about the, you know, recapping the neighborhood association meetings and the results of the survey. I want to make sure that above all else, that we allow you the time that you need in order to finalize the decision. So what I could do is I could just fast forward here, show you the results of the survey so that you are aware of how they came in, using that as a tool then for your finalization. Or we can just skip right to the finalization if you like. It's up to you.
Why don't you, since people did the survey, we need to honor the time that they spent doing it. So,
I'll go through that quickly.
Go through that real quickly. And then what we're gonna do is we're gonna start down there at District 1. Everybody's going to have like a minute or two to say what they need to say. We're going to work our way around the room so that everyone will have the opportunity to be heard. Then we'll figure out where we go next from there.
Okay. Okay, great. All right, so 14 out of the 32 committee members completed the second survey. So 14 of you completed the survey. Two basic questions were asked. And they were the same basic questions as we did the first time, which was, first question was, please rank the 13 remaining proposed neighborhood improvement areas in the order that they should be prioritized. The highest ranked one was area number one, which is in District 1. The second highest ranked one was Lincoln Park in District 2. And the third highest one was the West Side, which is area number 10 in District 5. So you can see along the right-hand side there how they ranked from highest to lowest, okay? So I wanted to show you that.
And could you please give us just like a quick overview of the community input, because some of our committee members would like to hear that.
You want me to go back and brief you on the Neighborhood Association meetings? Okay. Okay. So we had two meetings with neighborhood associations last week. We invited all of the organized neighborhood associations in the city to attend these, and we invited them by mail and by email. So these two meetings, 67 residents attended the meeting, so a pretty good turnout between these two nights. These residents represented more than 30 neighborhood associations and community organizations. 9 of you also attended, so thank you very much, all of you who attended those meetings. The key takeaways that we got from the input provided by residents who attended these meetings were, number one, that they wanted to know that design guidelines were going to be in place that ensure compatibility with the character of the neighborhood. And so the answer to that is yes, we take that feedback very seriously, and yes, it will be a part of the process. Second thing is the use of displacement and eminent domain, and we reiterated to them, and we reiterate to you, as we have been doing, that our intention is not to include the use of eminent domain or displacement in this bond process. The third one is to consider a post-election process for resident input. We have been hearing that from multiple people over the last few weeks, and we also take that very seriously. There will be a resident input process. We are examining different models for that. There are models that create robust citizen input that have been used in other cities that have done a housing bond process. So we're examining different models, but there will be a process in place. So we wanted to share that. And then lastly, I just wanted to mention that there were a number, as you can imagine, of specific recommendations for us to consider either the inclusion or the removal of small or large areas, and we looked at each of those very carefully, as we have done with the help of input all along the way from you and other stakeholders, and so those incremental changes were integrated into the maps as we currently have them. Okay, so the other thing that I wanted to mention to you on the survey results is when we asked you the question, are there any areas that you believe should not be included, and if so, which ones? First of all, I'll say that 9 of the 14 respondents mentioned at least one area that they believe should not be recommended. And so 56% of you suggested that area number 13, the one we were calling Wurzbach, not be included. 44% of you suggested that areas number 7, number 5, and number 17, that the last one was Oak Hollow, also should not be included for consideration. Now, it's important to recognize with Oak Hollow, that was without the benefit of discussion and orientation to that area. So I want to point that out. Here they are in the order from highest number of votes to lowest number of votes, the first one being the highest number of votes to exclude that area or to remove that area. We hope that these two slides are useful to you as you now move into the finalization of the areas, okay? Oh, okay, so we have one more thing to show you. We also organized the two surveys side by side so that you could see the cumulative effect of the two surveys, and we're going to pull that up for you right now. Again, we don't want to interfere with the time that you need, however, to make the decisions that you need to make.
It's going to show the ones that should be included.
So this information that we're about to show you indicates which ones, essentially, you all as the committee members indicated should be included. This is the cumulative effect.
Okay.
based on the survey results. Of course, you can then use that as a tool in your discussion.
Sorry, just a moment.
It's almost ready.
The anticipation is killing me. This is so exciting.
While you guys are working on that, Tom, we're going to start with you down there. Do you have something you'd like to say to the group?
Thank you for working hard. You're creating something that's never existed before. That's never easy. It takes trust and risk, listening, and playful hope. I want to underline the four things that Richard just highlighted from the neighborhood meetings. We're looking at context-sensitive housing that fits the existing neighborhood. We're honoring no eminent domain, no displacement of current residents. We have said, yes, there will be a role for maybe even some of us in an ongoing way to work with city staff and the council to implement the decisions as this thing unfolds. And city staff has apparently been receptive and responsive and added some tiny parcels to existing areas reflecting those two neighborhood meetings. That's healthy. We can support it, and let's get on with it. Thank you.
Okay, so you have up on the screen the rankings from the two different surveys, and you can see how the two areas fall out.
And I just wanted to mention there were 26 respondents to the first survey, and there were 14 respondents to the second survey. But I think the general list looks similar, nevertheless, as you look at them.
Okay. And Jeanette.
And Tom said it really well. I'm really excited about the opportunity that we have to build some affordable housing and really improve our city. I think one thing that I would ask is that I hope that we continue, if this goes forward, that we continue the community involvement as we, you know, move forward with this. But yeah, I'm really excited to vote, and to mimic Tom, let's get on with it.
Mr. Dickerson.
No doubt a controversial subject in one heck of an opportunity. There have been times I seriously felt like I was lost in trying to keep abreast of all of the questions and statements and email, and then subsequently coming to the meetings and listening to all of the dialogue. I'm not sure I'm yet at that stage where I'm truly comfortable trying to explain it all to someone else. So I have absolutely no problem with all of the dialogue that takes place at these meetings. I think it further facilitates my understanding, and I hope toward the end we can come to some resolve that hopefully will benefit not only the neighborhoods impacted, but the city in general.
Joy.
Yes, I'd like to thank our committee chairs and my fellow committee members and all of the city staff. This has been quite an undertaking, and we're just one committee. So God bless you all. And I too am really excited about this. I just love that statement, creating housing for working families. And I think that's a noble cause, and I'm proud to be a part of a city that would take this on. And so I hope that we can have a great success and have an opportunity to prove that it can be done. We can team up with other cities that are doing that in this country and set a standard as some of the other cities are. And when I look at this map, I see that San Antonio is very vast, and I'm sure there are plenty of other areas that could have been considered. And so I really don't think that we're casting the net too wide. To me, it looks just like a small portion of San Antonio. And so I really wouldn't want us to probably exclude. We've excluded some others at the last meeting, and there was great evidence as to why those would have been excluded. But as I continue to look tonight, I think that I like the areas that are there, including the areas in District 3, which would be the Southeast, the Roosevelt Mission Reach, and East South Cross. So we definitely want those included. But thank you to everyone. And I just really value all the input that everybody has and the different perspectives. And I think we make a great team. Thank you.
Likewise, all the thank yous, and I won't spend any more time on that. But I think when the city council members take a look at our list here and see that we have agreed as a group that this is the, you know, that this is the ranking that we feel very comfortable with, I feel very comfortable that they too then will be able to move and make decisions. Thank you.
Ms. Gomez.
Just wanted to thank everybody.
Ms. Sanchez.
I know we put a lot of hard work into adding, removing, doing what we need to do. We've spent a lot of time discussing this and a lot of really great ideas, so it's nice to know that there's this many people who care about this committee and it's well represented. I do agree with several of the other committee members that we've come up with a really good proposed list. We have shortened it, and we have added areas that we think are in great need. And as it's been stated, not all these areas are going to get hit. We know that. And it's council's job now to see where they can use the money and make those improvements. But we've given them a good starting list so that they don't have to feel like they don't have any options and instead they table it completely. So I like the idea of having this many options because, I mean, who doesn't like options? I'd rather go to a restaurant and have a menu full of choices than two or three things that say you have to choose from these, and then, oh wait, we don't have any of this stuff on the menu. So that's my thought.
As far as my feedback, I think we need to go ahead. I don't like the idea of tabling anything. You know, the main concern we have here is affordable housing, and that's what we need to go ahead and stick to as far as our charter. So I am a little bit displeased as far as the survey, where they gave us an opportunity to go ahead and do that. And like that, they talked about 26 out of the 30 something, and then now 14 out of the 32. I mean, the key point to me is affordable housing. We need to make this available. So I don't like the idea of tabling anything. I think we need to go ahead and continue, pursue what our charter was, and do it. Thank you.
I'd just like to thank everyone for their patience with me. This has been an extraordinary learning process, and I am grateful for all of the ideas and all of the things that I've heard at these meetings, so thanks very much.
I just want to thank the city for this opportunity to be working on this pilot program, but I do think that we should table this until we can have more citizens, neighborhood associations, and organizations have more time to think about all this that we've been taking. I came on late to the committee, so me too, I was having a hard time. But that's what I would choose.
I want to thank everyone because as we all stated that there was a lot of confusion, and I think from the way that we looked, when we look at how we voted, I think the top three are very much in need of a project like this. And I can see in the future that, moving a few years from now, when it's all said and done, that we will be proud. And these areas need it the most. And I think we did really good. Thank you.
(Clears throat)
the nobility of this bond offers great respect for the mayor and for the councilman of this district. But this bond was never intended to be this way. The reason that it was changed was because the city charter does not allow for the city to spend money on home repairs. So based on that, the charter is going to be changed in the very near future. So I would suggest that you people get behind your city councilman and advocate for this purpose. Because this was based on the city bond for Austin. What might be affordable to you might not be affordable to me. So it depends on your income as a senior citizen. But we have senior citizens in San Antonio that have been contributing long before some of these people got here with tax money. So we deserve to be awarded in some way or another. It didn't happen this way. So, but I do agree that this bond should be passed and approved by the way that it's prioritized, and try to later on give a little bit to each community. Thank you.
Well, first of all, I want to thank the staff, because I don't know if how many questions all of you have asked, but I flooded them, and it's been very last minute, and tonight I put them on the spot a couple times and got responses to my questions. And I think they've done a tremendous job about at least earning my trust in everything they did. And I asked some challenging questions, and I did ask and present to you some other challenging questions we need tonight. And I want to thank you all, each of you, in this process for your very open communications, sharing your concerns and questions, because I got educated. Yeah, this may have been confusing at first, but it didn't take me too long to figure out what our real charter was. And so I'm ready to go forward and support this. But lastly, I really want to support the community members that have sat silent but for 2 minutes, except at our other meetings, for coming out and giving us their feedback so we find the best program for San Antonio. And many of them, I guess, are sitting back here who aren't in the room. But I want to say thank you to you, because you were very open at the 2 meetings we held outside of this chamber. And I appreciate your input tremendously. Thank you.
I, too, would like to thank everyone. I'm proud to live in San Antonio. You guys are a great representative group. And I can say that because this is not my first bond committee. I've served on a number of them over the years. And you guys have been the most participatory of any bond committee that I've ever sat at. And you all are very thoughtful human beings. And that's a wonderful thing. The one thing I want to add is, in the future, because we all presume this is going to pass and it's going to move forward with our urban renewal program, citizen oversight. We cannot, in my humble opinion, have anything less than a 10-member citizen oversight committee for this initiative, one from each council district. And the reason is, we're all paying for it. We all live in this city. It's, you know, we care about one another. So we should all have a little bit of skin in the game, meaning at least one representative. And because this is new, and we need the diverse discussion like we've had, maybe two from each city council district. And you know what? It wouldn't hurt my feelings at all if all 30 of us, if you're willing, would be nominated to be the oversight committee, at least for the first year or two, to ensure, because, you know, we don't see eye to eye. We've crossed swords a little bit, but we haven't thrown chairs at one another. So that's a good thing. But we seem to all be on the same sheet of music. We all have that same vision now, as they say. And I would ask you to go back to the city council person that appointed you and say, you know, we need a minimum of 10, if not more. And I thank you also very much.
Thank you, co-chair. This is a great thing that you're doing right now. I'm glad that I'm getting to hear from everyone, even the people who don't often speak. And thanks to both of you for doing a tremendous job and for your patience with us. I can ask for a little bit more patience. Thanks to staff also. You have been very responsive to us. Truly appreciate that. I'm sure this isn't easy, especially because it's the first time you do this, and it took a lot of creativity. And who would have thought that after that first meeting that we had, we would be having this love fest right now at our last meeting? I know, I think all of us were sort of wondering what, you know, what's the other person trying to do? And thanks to the committee members, especially those who seem to be doing their homework on this all the time. Every time I've spoken with you, Bill, you have some new fact that you've researched, or Peggy Sue will open a binder that she's acquired of a ton of other information. Thank you for informing me about all that work. And I agree with Mr. Dina. I think because we're invested in this process, we want to see it succeed, and having a group to shepherd it through, or at least keeping an eye out for the process, I think it would be good for the city, and I think we would let us help you in that way. So I hope you'll take that under consideration. Thanks.
Well, I'd certainly echo all of the thanks to all of my fellow committee members and also to staff for all of their hard work on this. I think staff came with a really good set of recommendations to begin with, and that's made our job easy. It's just about us tweaking them, essentially. I think that the demand for affordable housing now is staggering in San Antonio. If you read the Thick report, you know, by it's 153,000 units unmet demand for affordable housing, which is just staggering. It's really paramount that we do something about that. We start doing something about that now. It's a huge demand now. It's only going to grow. We actually have an opportunity now, before things get to crisis situation like they are in Austin. We have an opportunity to get ahead of the curve. This is, you know, a very small ask of voters. I really believe that the majority of people will approve it. If not, then, you know, we lick our wounds and we try again, and at least that conversation is goes outside of this room and into the general community. So I really think it's a win-win proposition. If voters do approve it, I trust that you know, staff will do everything they can to ensure that it's successful. And I'd also remind everybody that, as we've been told, there's a whole lot of public process that goes into every decision about what property to purchase, how to clean it up, who to convey it to develop affordable housing. None of this is going to be done in a vacuum. It's all going to be open for public discussion. Even after this leaves here, it's going to go to City Council for public hearing. So the potentially affected neighborhoods and adjacent property owners will all have an opportunity to weigh in at many, many points throughout this process. So I would just say that, you know, I'm fully in support. I really think we have to do that. We have to give voters the opportunity to weigh in on this. Thank you.
So I think most of the key points have already been made. I would echo the comments around staff and the co-chairs in their support. I think we learned a lot during this process, and because it is new, and I think one of the most important learnings is that we need to involve the community early and often. And I hope that 5 years from now, when people sit down to do this once again, that learning isn't lost and we don't have to retrace our steps and we get it right the first time. It's not a criticism, it's the first time out of the box, but I think we all felt that was really valuable. The second point I would make has already been made, but I think it's worth iterating. I think a lot of the confusion here is because staff was trying to get a square peg into a round hole, and we're the force that's trying to make that happen. And that is because of the way in which we're constrained by city charter. So I too agree that it would be very helpful that the next time a group of folks like this sits around, they are not so constrained. I also completely agree with the thought process that in general, within reason, the more options you have in life is better. I tend to disagree with really narrowing the list any more than it is. I do have a certain trust in the city manager and city council with the appropriate oversight. I think we've got a reasonable list. And from my perspective at this point in time, I'm perfectly comfortable moving forward with that list. Thank you again, and thank you for the time.
Thank you, everybody. It's been a pleasure to serve on this committee and learn about our city process on the bond issue. I would reiterate what everybody has already said. I would agree with everything. The only thing I would add is, and it kind of goes to the point that has been raised about the neighborhood services tagline that's been given to this committee. And perhaps, as has been addressed by Chris, it's more of a semantics because of the charter. But in terms of going back to the point that was made is how can we educate the community or, you know, about what is exactly this housing bond project is maybe get the creative minds from ad agencies that work so closely with the city to come up with a creative way in which we can sell this and make it more understandable to our citizens.
Okay, I'll be quick. So thank you to everyone, to the staff. I think we, you know, we're facing a reality in San Antonio that income disparity continues to grow. I think that the time for this bond is now. I don't feel comfortable with saying let's wait. I feel comfortable with moving forward with this now. This is an issue of equity and justice. I also want to say that I echo the sentiment that although maybe the charge of this committee ends today, the charge that we feel individually as citizens and representatives of our parts of the city should and will keep going. We've talked about yes committees, and I know that specifically Anna Sandoval and myself are looking forward to bringing forth a document recommendations from whoever is interested in being a part of this, talking about feedback on the process, accountability, transparency, and our recommendation for the urban renewal plan. So I invite you to be a part of this with us, and I'm looking forward to having the voters approve this.
I'd just like to thank everyone for having me and for all the hard work and for working with my co-chair with the Housing Commission, Jackie Gorman. Of course, thanks to the city staff and everybody for doing all the hard work that everyone's done. In general, I support the general consensus that everyone has come up with here collectively. But as a succinct statement, I support recommending the top 10 areas of the most recent survey results to City Council. Thank you.
I appreciate the exchange of ideas we've had on this committee. We may not always agree, but I think we always have San Antonio and its citizens at heart. Having said that, I ask you to realize that only part of the near west Five Point area is all that remains of the original recommendations of the city staff. Somewhere eliminated one of them on my recommendation just because I felt the one that was in District 9 was not ideal. I don't think any of those recommendations were a part of Not In My Backyard. I realize that there's the need for affordable housing in every area of town. And so I ask you to consider the nurse's aide that gets off at 3 a.m, whatever time she's had to work over. And she has to commute all the way from the south, the east, or the west side from the medical center, either by bus, which has reduced service at those hours, or by car, and realize that housing in the medical center, we need to leave the Wurzbach area is small areas and is probably going to be priced out of our league because it's more conducive to commercial, I feel we really need to leave the Oak Hollow on there as a possibility. Thank you.
I have a great respect, admiration, and appreciation for this entire process. It's been transparent. City staff has been incredibly responsive to all of our requests. They've been many and in some cases excessive, but I really appreciate getting the additional maps and charts and information to help us think through all of this. I think as a result of that and the bus tour and the meetings with the HOAs, there have been some key points that have come up that we know now can be emphasized as the public is to be informed prior to the vote. And the biggest ones are no one's going to be displaced, we're not going to use eminent domain, and that this is not affordable housing like we've known it in the past, the projects necessarily. This is workforce affordable housing. So I think that's really key in terms of informing anyone and everyone about this as we go forward. Because as we saw, as we heard with the numbers, the projected growth for the city of San Antonio, it's not a matter of if they, we build it, will they come. They're coming, so we need to build it. And I think everyone here would like for this to be successful. So I think that it's our responsibility to put forward the areas that are really most likely to succeed for consideration. I think we could actually narrow it down to 8 to 10 areas. But overall, I'm really pleased with the process and glad to have been part of it. Thank you.
I couldn't agree with you more on everything you said, Sylvia. We have some big challenges and hurdles. When I try to explain this to my husband, one minute I'm talking urban renewal, the next minute I'm talking affordable housing, the next minute I'm talking neighborhood improvements, and he says, well, which one is it? And what's the definition of each one? So we do have some challenges. But as the seventh largest city in the United States, we need to take some action. And that bus tour was a real eye-opener. We need some money to fix some of these areas, and we need to do it right. I think another really large hurdle for our committee is we're creating maps to fit into a plan that doesn't even exist yet. We saw a draft of a plan that had gaping holes in it, didn't address the issues of eminent domain and a few other areas. So I'm going to put my faith that the final draft is good so that I can support this to our district members. Thank you for the staff for the enormous amount of information you gave us.
So I do believe everybody here wants us to succeed. And right now, as it stands, with the list as it is, I do not believe that will occur. And this is the main reason why. And I can't stress enough, this is being a pilot, but take a step back for a second and recognize that the goal is for us to come up with a list of projects that the council will say, we want to put this on the ballot, and that the voters are going to say, yes, this is what we want. We've been meeting since October. And like clockwork, every single meeting quickly diverts into a discussion of projects. Today, our chair and Peter, again at the beginning, had to remind us we are not here to pick projects. There's 30 people here, 30 smart individuals. If it's that confusing for us, how confusing is it going to be for the voters? And let me remind you, it is very easy to lose credibility with the voter. It is extremely difficult to build it with them. And if voters believe that they are voting on a project or a house that is going to be built within their area, and it is not built, they are highly unlikely to vote for this to pass next time. And so when you increase it, you are taking a gamble that voters are going to understand this when we couldn't understand it. And that being the case, I think that it is too high, and we are increasing the chance for city staff not to succeed if we leave it at this current length.
Well, first of all, I'd like to also say thank you to everyone. Pero lo voy a decir en español. Le doy muchas gracias a este comité. Le doy gracias a los empleados del concilio. Le doy gracias a mi consejero del Distrito 10 por darme esta oportunidad. I said what everybody else said, but in Spanish. So, I've sat here and listened to a lot of extremely smart people and people with heart, people who care. I unfortunately agree with Ricardo that the people who need this are not going to understand it. And if we do not do it right the first time, there will not be a next time. And someone here said, let's get on with it. We've done all of this, you know, let's move on. I'd like to be a part of a winning team. And we may not make the ultimate decision, but the media will definitely go to the committee and say, well, you're the ones that make the suggestions. And you know why they're going to do that? Because they don't understand it. I'm afraid that the bond, the entire bond, not just this particular issue, will fail if we're not careful. We have not given thought to all the other projects and committees that are working on this particular bond. So I want you to really give it some thought when the time comes for us to make this vote, because we do care about the people that are in need of housing, what we call the working poor. There's a lot of working poor out there in San Antonio, and they do deserve better. And I want us to give them better. But if we don't think about it and it fails, they'll never trust again. Thank you.
Well, I want to thank everyone for all the comments. This was a great idea by my co-chair, Jackie, in that throughout these meetings, we haven't had the opportunity to hear from everyone. So Jackie put everyone on the spot tonight and made you say something. And I think for the most part, what I heard was that there's a lot of optimism by the committee members in our city, in the ability for us to make good decisions and be stewards of what's been placed in front of us. As people went around the room, I was making some notes, and I heard, but for the most part, everyone has been very positive about what we're doing and how we're moving forward. I heard things like, let's get on with it, I'm excited. I heard someone say they were excited to create housing, it's a noble cause. They're comfortable with the rankings, we've come up with a very good list, we don't need to table this. So it sounds to me like, in listening to everyone, and especially those who haven't really commented that much throughout the process, that you've thought about this deeply, you've been concerned about it, you want to do what's right for the city. I don't get the impression from the majority of committee members here that there's confusion on their part. They know what their duty is, they know what has been asked of them, and they're ready to commit and move forward. I do understand that some people still have some reservations, but I think for the most part, everyone has done an outstanding job. We've come up with what I feel like is a good list. Whether we narrow it down by, you know, a few more areas, it's subject to this committee for a final vote. But I want to commend everyone on the work that they did. I'm excited to have heard from everyone. And I want to thank you for your participation and the optimism you have for the future of our city. So thank you.
Civic responsibility. You know, when each of us accepted the appointment to serve on this committee, there was a certain amount of responsibility that went along with that. You know, we committed to being here, and we've done a pretty good job of that. We committed to being engaged, and I think we've done an excellent job of that. We committed to doing the best that we could do in the time that we had, and I think we've done a great job with that. I think we have learned our charge. Our charge does not end tonight, though. And I think it's real important that everyone understands that. When we walk out of this door tonight, our role is not over. It's really just beginning, because we then become the ambassadors for this. We are the translators. So when you go to your neighborhood association meeting and they're talking about this, it's going to be up to you, because you were sitting here all these times, to explain to them what it is that we're doing. And we need to be really clear that we can all do that. And I think that it's important. One of the most amazing things about this process has been that we came to this first meeting from very different places, ideologically, politically, what we thought about this issue. And throughout the whole thing, we managed through a process of civil discourse to come together and try to work toward a solution. And I think that in these divisive times in our country and in our community, the fact that 32 citizens could sit down together and have respectful disagreements, conversations where we all learned something, where you could leave the table and say, well, you know what, Peggy Sue, I didn't agree with you, but I understand what you told me, then we've done something amazing here. So I just wanted to say that and thank all of you and thank the staff for giving us the amazing support that you did. So I guess our next question is, does anyone have a motion that they'd like to put forth? Joy.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to make a motion to put forth all of the properties that are on the list as shown there on the screen for approval by City Council.
Is there a second to that motion? Who is that? I can't see. Ms. Cota, was that you? Oh, okay, Linda Lopez George. All right, it's been properly moved and seconded that we recommend to City Council the inclusion of all of the 13 areas that are listed on the screen there as to be included in the urban renewal plan. Briefly, is there any discussion other than what we have already said? Anything new? Hearing none, we're going to ask staff to take us through a roll call, please.
Claudia, which is not absent, sorry. Tom?
Yes.
Ann?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Beverly? No. Not here, sorry. Joy?
Yes.
Elaine? Carla? Andrea?
Yes.
Rodolfo?
Yes.
Tinker?
Yes.
Natalie? Trisha? Jim?
Yes.
Jackie?
Yes.
Lauro?
Yes.
Bill?
Nay.
Nay. Dominique?
Nay.
Anna? Michael?
Yes.
Chris?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Coda?
Si.
George?
Yes.
Colleen?
Yes.
Sylvia?
Yes.
Peggy?
No.
Ricardo?
No.
And Connie?
Abstain.
Yes. 22 yeses.
I have 22 yeses. I have four noes and one abstention.
One abstention. Yes.
So the motion passes.
Motion passes. Everybody. Peter or Richard, did you guys want to give us a quick draft overview of the urban renewal plan?
Thank you, Jackie. We will just take 1 minute. We're just going to put the PowerPoint back up. This, what we're going to show you is just a quick slide. It's in your presentation. And as we said tonight, we'll email you the urban renewal plan in its first draft format. But what it will include is this here on the screen. There'll be a general description of the approved eligible areas that City Council will ultimately approve, similar to the slides that you have seen, the geographic area and some of the descriptions of it. We'll have a scope in this document of what is going to be done, or potentially could be done, what are some of the eligible activities that we'll do. We'll talk about some of the development requirements. This is something that you all talked about consistently. So there'll be language in there about minimum affordability requirements. That, as an example, is 80% of the area median income. So somebody making a family of four, about $45,000, they would qualify. People making more than that wouldn't. So that'll be something listed in there. There'll be some design guidelines that you have talked about as well consistently. And so that the new development is compatible with existing neighborhoods, that'll be listed in this urban renewal plan. That'll kind of make sure we do this when we ultimately roll the program out. And then there'll be some description about opportunities for leveraged funding that could come from the city or from other areas as well, how additional dollars could be brought to the housing development or the area. Okay, so this is just a general overview of what will be in the urban renewal plan. You all had asked that we kind of go over this a little bit more with you. And this is what this is tonight, but you'll actually get the actual document in a few weeks from now when we first post it for the public hearing. That's it, Jackie.
Does anybody have any questions for Peter? Richard, do you have anything you need to leave us with?
No, thank you all very much for your active and dedicated participation in this process. We absolutely appreciate it, and you helped to make what we arrived at better than what we started with. Thank you very much.
Let me just make a few comments, and then we'll close the meeting. Staff will be compiling the final list of areas based on our actions tonight, which will be presented to City Council on Wednesday, December 14th, which the Mayor and City Council will then take under review. City Council will take formal action regarding the approval of the areas for urban renewal on Thursday, December the 15th at the City Council meeting. Staff will be sending out an email and update calendar invites summarizing these and other important dates. Again, the B session meeting is 2 o'clock on next Wednesday, the 14th. If you can make that, great. It'd be nice to see people in attendance to support the work that we've done here tonight and over the last 2 months. And then it will go to City Council at the City Council public meeting the following day for formal approval. I want to thank everyone for their participation and attendance. It's been very challenging, and as has been said, we've heard from some very, very highly educated and well-intentioned people to do the right thing for the City of San Antonio. So I want to thank everyone. Have a good evening. If there's no other business, then we'll... One more point, Hannah.
Thank you. I just want to reiterate what my colleague Coda brought up, is we are planning to work together to submit a document to staff and to council regarding our comments on the process, suggestions for next time, as well as comments on the urban renewal plan itself. If you would like to work with us, we'll reach out to you nonetheless, but if you would like to work with us, please shoot me an email or talk to me after the meeting, and we would love to have your, basically your names on the document with us when we submit it, so that it's a strong comment coming from the committee. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Anna. This meeting is adjourned.